this is a public mess. This is it was a private mess of 7 o'clock this went, but didn't.
I know.
You know this.
Things are bad, and until accountability sometimes is arrived at,
things can only get worse. A church which denies help and compassion to these little ones, as we were, and continues on its great way of not seeing the wood from the trees, can at best be engaged with or indulging in real injustice. On February 8th, 2010, I wrote a letter to the Holy Father, and in my letter I declared that my church, my country, and the general Irish public had inflicted enormous cruelty and pain and hardship on me throughout my life. There was hope in my heart as I awaited a reply. There was no reply, only a deafening silence. Even though I had handed over my epistle to a bishop, requesting that it be delivered to the Pope. That same apathy and indifference that crucified us as children is being shown to us as I talk to you. But we are not going away. The future history books of Ireland will tell our story. Shame. Where is thy blush? When I ask people if they can guess how many children went into the industrial schools, some guess at 10,000, which is a big number, some guess at 20,000. And when I tell them to double it and double it again, they are astonished. 170,000 children, including myself and my two brothers, Liam and Sean, were permitted to the industrial schools between 1937 and 1970. This happened as a result of distant court activities, and the reason for our sentence was poverty. The average length of confinement was 7 years. Sean, Liam, and myself, we served 35 years. 35 years is half a lifetime. Sean was 3, I was 5, and Liam was 7. We were not born babies. Our crime was we were born poor. On May 11, 1999, the government of this country apologized to us. On behalf of the state and on behalf of the citizens of the state, for collective failures to intervene in our suffering, failure to detect our pain, and failure to come to our rescue. Some 10 years later, on May 20, 2009, the Ryan Report was published. In the light of what this revealed, the above apology went nowhere near far enough. A month later, the Ryan Report came before the door. On that day, Michael O'Brien and I sat in the public galleries and we cried as we listened to the speeches by TDs, which were a reflection and expression of what our lives were like as children. That day, Emily Kenny, father of 3 children, made the following very powerful remarks, and I quote these words. The report of the Ryan Commission shames us all. It shames us as a state and as a society. We stand complicit in the criminalization of little children as a consequence of this policy. But that's just the beginning. This state was responsible for the destruction of life itself. It was responsible for the destruction of that precious, formative gift, childhood. We should all be haunted by what life found out, because he has revealed a great famine of compassion, a plague of deliberate, relentless cruelty. We stand shamed, and we must not excuse ourselves of that shame. Unquote. This denunciation of our nation puts us in the company of is to our own, the most vulnerable in our society, the most deserving, and the least demanding. Shame, where is thy blush? These are the words of our present teacher, Andy Kennett, energized by what he had discovered within the forest of the Lion of Court. As a survivor of the industrial schools, I thank our teacher for his ringing words, which paint a picture of cruelty that no child should ever have to endure, especially honesty in my head. But words are no longer enough. We seek atonement for what happened to us from the state, the Irish people, and the church. The time for talking is over. Now, we have to go and look in all the crevices, park benches, railway bridges, and wherever the victims of this disgrace may be sheltered, and bandage their wounds, comfort their anxious minds, bring them back home if possible, and provide them with whatever they may need to compensate for their lack of education, their scarcity of social skills, and a shriveled humanity that we, by our meanness, force on them. Our bank of youth was burrowed by the system. As well as being incarcerated, we were physically abused and dehumanized. It was very difficult to stand in line, to be patient and wait for a turn, when we already knew that there was not enough as usual for everyone. It was the survival of the fittest. When there is an epidemic of poverty in an institution, it doesn't take a medical expert to realize what is going on. We were, like the good Lord, being crucified and made a mockery of, and no one came to our rescue. Peter denied knowing Christ. We were denied all along the line. Remember, I have not mentioned the unmentionable sexual. Through our suffering, they crucified again the Son of Man and made a mockery of him. Why? The full brunt of man's inhumanity was laid on Christ, rather than King of redemption. This foreshadows what happened to us. And for that reason, what happened to Jesus strikes a deep chord in our hearts. Is there life at the end of the tunnel? There can be, but only if the perpetrators of our misery answer our humble plea for atonement. They must ask us for forgiveness, and we will forgive. They must ask our Heavenly Father for the one thing, as Jesus did, on the grounds that they knew not what they did. But insofar as they did know, we are asking from the state, the Irish people, the religious congregations, and the Catholic Church itself for a national, annual Day of Atonement, Day of Atonement, where all of the perpetrators together, according to their lights, ask our forgiveness, and the forgiveness especially of those who are in various degrees of trauma, physical pain, and feel excluded from the mainstream of Irish life, are as a result of what was inflicted upon them. We must not forget the ones who did not survive. There are little, mostly unmarked graves dotted around our beautiful Ireland, from Letterfrack back all the way to Artena, containing the remains of gentle souls who could not survive.